Myself Allah. And Maulana Rafi Karo has been appointed to, we chose the topic, the start of Islam in South Africa. So I will just do us some skimming over the history, and inshallah, just to give our Sheikh also some, you know, work to do. He will do the details, inshallah, of this history. So it started with the Indonesian or Malaysian people, right? In 1652, roundabout, when Zan van der Riebe came to Cape Town. And part of the reason why he came to Cape Town was because at the time they had difficulties going to the east. There was a fight between the Dutch and the British. So they couldn't go through the east, through the Mediterranean side, and they would come down, right down to Cape Town and go around. So they started this Cape of Good Hope. In that time also, the Dutch also colonized a lot of places, and Indonesia was one of those places. And then there was a fighting going on between the Indonesian people. Right about the time when the Dutch in 1644 roundabout, when they came to Indonesia and started colonizing a lot of places, a Sheikh Yusuf wasn't a Sheikh at the time. He went to Makkah, where he went for Hajj, and Sheikh Yusuf then studied for about 20 years. And then he became an alim there, etc. And then he came back to his hometown, finding that his home place has been taken over by the Dutch and colonized. And then when he, this is the time when he went to, I think they call it Bantam or Bantam, you know, when he went to that place, and there was a prince who welcomed him in the area. Also, knowing his status, gave his daughter to Sheikh Yusuf to get married to Sheikh Yusuf. Sheikh Yusuf then stayed there for quite some time. And then eventually this whole Dutch colonization thingy came over to the place where he was staying in Bantam. And people were fighting, and Sheikh Yusuf was part of these political, not the rebels, what do you call it, Sheikh?
Uprising,
yes. Resisting all of this new change and new political arena that they're entering into. And because of this, Sheikh Yusuf, amongst other Indonesians, was sent to South Africa because of the uprising that they used to cause in Indonesia. So they thought to themselves, we have a place in not known as South Africa at the time, but we have a place in Cape of Good Hope. Why don't we send all of these people to that place where they can then, you know, stay away from what we are trying to achieve? Because at the time, the British and the Dutch, they were fighting each other for power over the East Asian countries and East Asian places because of the spices and because of the gold that, you know, it existed at the time there. So to remove the issues out of the area, they sent Tuang or Sheikh Yusuf. They send him to Cape Town with his two wives at the time, Sheikh Mulabetu. So, with his two wives, mashallah, sending him to Cape Town. And then, not only in Cape Town where Jan van der Riebe and his people were, but much later came to Cape Town in the 90s. But they send him to a place that was known as Zandvliet at the time. Right? Today it's known as Makassar in our area. It's known as Makassar. Part of the reason why it is known as Makassar is because Sheikh Yusuf, with his two wives and the other 40 odd people that came from the very first people of, that came to South Africa, they came from this place known as Makassar in Indonesia. So when they, at the time it was known as Zandvliet, and after, in honor of Sheikh Yusuf, when he passed away, they named this place and they called it Makassar, in honor of Sheikh Yusuf. And he was known also as Tuan Yusuf, which means Master Yusuf, because of his great knowledge and his service that he rendered to the community. And then also some other luminaries were sent, also princes and other people. One of the names that Sheikh also will be touching on is Prince Abdullah Qadi Abu Salam, who was known as Tuan Guru, which is two titles. Tuan meaning master and Guru meaning teacher. So he had two titles. Tuan Guru is known by the people because of, you know, the knowledge that he had. When they imprisoned him, when they sent him down to Cape Town, the very first thing they wanted to do with the Muslims is that they wanted the Muslims to be separate. You know, so they would send Sheikh Yusuf to one place as a leader, Zanzibar, now known as Makassar. Sheikh Abdullah Qadi, Tuan Guru as we know him, they would send him to Robben Island. And then also another sheikh that they also sent to Robben Island. While this sheikh was in Robben Island, he wrote the whole Quran from memory, which became the first Quran ever in South Africa. Right? And this Quran is still to be found in the first masjid that was built in South Africa, in Cape Town, Dorpstraat, as we call it. Am I right? Dorpstraat? Is it Dorpstraat? Our masjid? Is it? Yes. Yeah, shukran, Sheikh West. You know his history, mashallah. I was just testing you, Sheikh. So, the very first Quran that was written, and they say that he also with the Tuan Sa'id, they were the first imams also in the area at the time, and he rendered a very great service for the community. He also started the writing. You know, like we use the I think we call it the Italian script. All right, so he started the script of Afrikaans where he had Arabic, but he would write Afrikaans in Arabic. You know, some people would call it Afribic. All right, so he started this style of writing, you know, the language of Afrikaans in Arabic, but unfortunately died out. All right. And then also in this time, in the 1700s, what is very important for everyone to know, I don't know how much time I have left, but what's very important for everyone to know is that the pioneers behind the youngest language in the world being Afrikaans is the Cape Muslims, not the Afrika, the Boere. Right? It's not the Boere that started the language Afrikaans. Right? The people behind the youngest language in the world, Afrikaans, being as a language, was the Cape Muslims. And at the time it was known as Cape Dutch. So the Cape Muslims were part of this. You know, there's a lot of words that is used. Like in Afrikaans, they didn't have a word for banana. And the word in Afrikaans for banana is pisang. You go to Malay and you ask for the Malaysian, you know, give me a pisang, they will understand exactly what you're saying and what you're requesting. Because the word banana in Malay means pisang. You know, the word bayam, like meaning a lot, that's also a Malay word. And right, so there was a lot of, a lot of words that was introduced in the Afrikaans that we know today. Baiki also, baksi, so see, colors they would say, baksi, baiki. And right, this is also a Malay word. You know, there's a lot of words that was introduced into the Afrikaans language by the Cape people. The 1 minute remaining. Okay. All right. So, by the Cape people, a lot of words were introduced, not only from the Malays, but from the Bushmen, or Khoisan people, yes. All right. The Griquasius, and from the Germans, from the English people, all of these people, they formed the language. But we in Cape Town were the pioneers behind this language until the Boere or the white people started moving out of Cape Town, and then they canonized or whatever, you know, formulated this language, and then they called it Afrikaans. Right? But it was started by the Cape Muslims. You know, so that's inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us an understanding. I will end off there, inshallah, because I would like to give some work for our sheikh here.